first question I have for you is, what got you into music in the first place?
I think my grandfather was probably one of my biggest influences. He was Italian and played mandolin, played a lot of polkas, Italian songs, that sort of thing. And I think he was just sort of really excited to teach me guitar. And I was little, so I didn't really take it seriously till I was much older. But at the time, he was the guy that was just so excited and smiling to, like, when I did something on the guitar growing up. And then my father played accordion and did some big band stuff. And he was really good. And we started a polka band called the Polecats with him, me playing drums, my brother playing bass.
So you weren't classically trained at all. This is all picking up instruments and learning as you go.
I was completely self-taught, even till now. Like, I don't really know much as far as, you know, technical terms.
Does that create any weakness for you or liability for you, or is it something that might even be liberating to be able to sort of do it on your own?
I've played with a lot of cats that are technically trained and very well trained. And when I say to them, I think I need, you know, I need to figure some stuff out and get an education on the stuff. And they're like, no, you got it. You're cool. So that's what I got to kind of go by is, it might take a little bit longer. I think that's frustrating, but I think that's kind of a cop out because, I think what I'm looking for is to speed up the process. And that might mean that if I have a cool idea, then I'll think, oh, I've got these options. You know, I would just go to them as opposed to, I would come up with a cool idea and then spend maybe a few days just riffing and getting that in my mind and coming up with something more original. So I think that's sort of what the benefit of that is.
How did Rusted Root even get originated? How did that start? Did you know one another, or were you put together by others? How did that get conceived?
I started Rusted Root in 1990, but in 1987, I was in college and got pretty depressed, very physically depressed, kind of having trouble lifting my arms off the couch, and started writing songs, very simple songs, just about a girl in the dorm, and it was pretty good. Actually, I think I wrote Cruel Sun back then, song Cruel Sun. But then I just started to, like, get excited and started to lift my arms up, just physically kind of getting up a little bit more. And I think what I started to identify is that there's this different reality that's very real, almost felt more real than the reality I was in at the moment. And it was this musical reality and songwriting and putting some stuff together that made complete sense to me and gave me a world that was just very liberating. So I kind of went with it. And so I dropped out of college, didn't tell my parents for like a year, just rented a storefront in a pretty sketchy part of Pittsburgh. It was $50 a month, a lot of rain coming in. And, I just started writing for 3 years and coming up with the vision of what I wanted for Rusted Root. And so then I put ads in the paper, and there were some people that came in. They were actually pretty good and kind of got me excited. And then I invited Liz down to the auditions, and we kind of hit it off. And then she knew kind of everybody through Pitt University.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it sounds like music was a voice you weren't able to allow to get expressed. And that sort of tapped into a creative energy that you couldn't tap into without it.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of grew up in a different world, like in my own internal world. And at 2.5 years old, I was hit by a car and almost died. And I was just kind of like, like very aware of sort of other realms. And so when music hit, kind of the stuff I was kind of made fun of for, like, was like a reality. And so I was just, it almost like brought tears to my eyes that I could connect with that on a...
Connect with yourself or connect with others?
Yeah, kind of connect with other realms and have it mean something. As opposed to just sort of be something in my head that people were looking at and going like, what's wrong with him, you know? Yeah. Like my brothers would make fun of me. I was just very airy and sort of airheaded and very spaced out. And so music kind of, I was able to take those thoughts and that world that I existed in and just kind of put it through. And people were like, I understand. And I was like, oh my God, like, holy shit.
When I listen to Rusted Root, I kind of feel like there's a lot of influences or genres that are sort of put together and create this kind of neat little conglomeration. And how did that come about? And were those influences that you just brought together, or were they brought upon you by other people?
No, it was all internal. The idea, the song, and the intention of the song, how it should feel, was internal. Things might have changed with the band, you know, like the drummer coming in and say, hey, try this. But it had the same energy that I was perceiving. But, you know, you say, like, where does that come from? I think it's past lives, personally. I think there was some, you know, African influences, maybe in a past life, some Middle Eastern, I think European, I think Irish, and, you know, even like Slovakian type influences that I could, you know, I can identify that come through. I think there's different angels for each of those worlds and sounds, and I think they speak to me, and I think it just comes through that. I can't explain it any other way.
Was there a time in the evolution where you felt like you had become a success? And what did success mean, if that was the case to you? And was that tangible? Did you feel a difference?
I think just like the first gigs where, you know, the audience was very passionate and just like kind of losing their minds in our set. I think that's a success. You know, I like smaller shows personally. I like being able to feel individuals in the audience. We've played the big success shows, like where you're playing, you know, Woodstock to 180,000 people and they're all watching the screen and watching you. And, that just kind of feels like you're almost like on TV or something. Like there's a big TV screen in front of you and there's not a lot of personal connection. Yeah. But I like to, those early shows where people are standing like 2 feet in front of you and they're dancing and kind of losing their mind. And it's kind of inspiring, like just to watch their bodies move individually. And you'd kind of go like, bam, bam, and make them move a little different. Like that's sort of, gives you knowledge of where you can go.
It's almost like you're dancing with them.
Yeah.
Is it more that, they just love the energy, or that they know your work and that is inspiring, that they recognize what you've done? So is it the newness of what you're sending out, or is it the awareness of what you've done that inspires you?
I think the early music for sure felt more communal. So what was coming to me and what I was presenting almost felt not really my own. It kind of came through in this bigger context. So when people were responding to it, I didn't feel personally, like my ego didn't get a jolt from it, but I felt, oh my God, I love that they are as passionate as I am about it, this world. And it felt real. I mean, it felt very real. and maybe even more real than other parts of my life, you know, where things weren't making sense. You know, there's so much about this world, obviously, like now, the world's kind of going a little crazy. That doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. And this world made sense.
You mentioned before that I think what I got from you is that your music is sort of tapping into a voice that wasn't really, you weren't able to express fully. Does any one song capture the essence of you the best? And is that the same song that resonates the most with the audience?
It's an interesting world, because like I said, sometimes they come through and they feel like they're not yours. They feel very communal. And there's other songs that do feel like more of my story, yeah, more personal. But yet still have that communal aspect to it. I'm in a more, like a more mixed space now, where it's not like I'm completely out of my mind writing. I'm in my mind a lot more in my experience. So I think right now I'm feeling like super excited about, just being able to tell my story, my personal story a little bit more than this communal giving.
Mm. Did any one song capture you? Like, is there any one song that you just have a soft spot for where you go, God, that's Michael. That is me, writ large.
Well, no, not really. I mean, I think maybe some of the newer stuff. I mean, 1988 that you heard tonight.
Yeah.
That's a very funky one. I think that sort of tells my world a little bit, tells my experience a little bit more and represents me. I think Heartache, which is also called Please Pick Up, is a newer song. And that kind of tells a story that I was in for maybe like an hour of my life. But it represents like sort of how my thoughts and feelings occur and what I was going through in that moment. And it's very real, and I think people connect to it. I think Welcome to My Party is kind of cool. People love that song, and it's also, you know, telling a story about my divorce. And so I feel like there's a lot of dudes that come up after that and are like crying and they're kind of going through similar things. And, you know, they'll kind of corner me and, you know, tell their story. And I'm like, you know, thanks for telling me that. I mean, that's some powerful stuff.
You had the band and you had an incredible rise for this moment, a chapter in time. And there was a period, I feel like, which was before then, a period of total chaos in that moment. And then the post chaos world, which has been the most gratifying experience? Is it before you became well known? Is it while you were well known? And
I think my most gratifying experience was before we became huge. Because we were part of a community and our fans would show up at our shows and they would bring food and potluck dinners and we'd sit and eat and talk to everybody. And it wasn't, you know, there's nothing weird about it. It was just...
Not contrived.
There was nobody getting like fanish on us. It was, they were part of it. We were part of it. And we went up and did our thing. I put the sound system together. We built the stage and we would just rent out a warehouse. It wasn't even a club. And everybody would just pack into this warehouse. And by the end of the night, everybody was completely sweat, you know, soaked. And we were sweat soaked. And, you know, the mists and the heat and the vapors were all intertwined and ingested. It was just great.
Is it fair to say that? That in some respects, when they know your material, does it become more structured, their appreciation, in that they know what to expect because they've heard it before? You've also performed the essence of it before. is it more liberating to introduce something that an audience has never heard before? And in that respect, it creates a more liberating, more authentic experience of you. Is that better than having known the material and adoring it, but does that create some boundary to the essence of it?
I think there's always an aspect of people knowing the music. Even in the early days, they knew it. They'd already heard it a couple of times. Like maybe the first time they heard it, they were just standing there and going like this, like, what the hell is this? And then they start to accept it and start to move their bodies. I think there's always that aspect. So I try to like each night, whether it's full band or whether it's the duo, change it up and bring something fresh to it each night. And the dynamics go in different ways. The inflections, the communication, sometimes like completely new parts come out each night. It's sometimes, I mean, especially this new band I got, Uprooted, it's crazy. Like these dudes are just super intuitive and super technically advanced. So I'm kind of sitting back and being a fan of them for my own music, you know, and they'll do stuff where I'm like, oh my God, I never heard this way before. And so I'm like smiling and laughing like the crowd and it's great.
But tell us about Uprooted and the composition of the band and what you have assembled.
So Uprooted is a drummer, Ricky Petraglia, and he's a pretty special dude. Very, like I said, very intuitive, but also has his own way of perceiving the music that is pretty special. That's all I can really say. It's hard to, you know, I can't describe its music. So, but then Eric Kramer on bass, he's the same way. He's got his own way of perceiving it and bringing energy to it. And every night he's completely different every night. Like he's just bringing something different all the time. Dirk Miller on guitar, which we had tonight. And then Emily Victoria on vocals. And Daisy Gusflower on vocals. And then Keaton Tandy on percussion.
It's a big group.
Oh yeah, seven piece.
What inspires you the most about what you've created with them?
I love them as people, like, which is really interesting because I wasn't expecting it. You know, it was like, you know, I'm in Rusted Root, I'm leaving Rusted Root, and I'm putting this band together, and all of a sudden, these people are like. Like everybody's super sort of loving and open and innocent. And I'm like, wow, like how did this happen? Mm. it was kind of magical. And so, just hanging out with them and bringing good energy to the music is, it's so easy. And, I'm so thankful for that.
Sounds like no expectations either.
No, I don't think we've ever rehearsed. I think everybody just kind of like heard the music and just popped up on stage.
Tell us about the effort that you're putting together in the album that's coming out soon.
Well, that's going to be the new album's going to be some work as far as figuring out how we're going to do it live. And, the album is pretty special. For the first time, I really sat down maybe last week and went like, wow, this is really cool. Like, I mean, I was never happy with recordings. This I put a lot of work into, and I spent many years learning how to record and learning how to produce from some of the best producers in the world. And
are you producing it?
Yeah.
Yourself.
Yeah. So I took my time. I mean, I think we've been working 6 years on this. But part of it is me learning different processes of recording. Like, for example, this might be a little hard to explain, But so we're, Uprooted is a very intuitive, magical live band. So we get up each night and there's something that happens each night that makes me laugh, but it never happens again. Right. So it's just in that moment. The next night, something happens. It never happens again. So it's just these things that are special in that moment. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to put together, say, like, 20 sessions of vocals and maybe with a percussionist. And, each time we come in, we do something completely different on a song. This is recording. So we have like the drums and the guitars figured out. And, so we'll come in, we'll do like 10 takes of all different stuff. These like little magical moments. And then a month later, we'll come back in and do the same thing. A month later, we'll kind of do the same thing, completely unconnected.
The same takes.
Yeah. Unknowing what we did before.
Or not remembering.
Not remembering.
Right.
So there's all this stuff and I'll go through and I'll edit. I'll spend like hundreds of hours going through this stuff and editing it and just kind of cleaning it up. And if something's like almost an idea, maybe I'll have people come back and we'll finish it. But I'll have these layers and layers of ideas that are all magical moments of live experience. And then you'll go through with these, you have maybe 20 layers of this stuff, and then you just kind of clean out what's working and what's magical between them from these different experiences. And when you clean that, when you clean it up and you put it all together, it's like nothing you've ever thought you could do or, it's just magical. It was a predetermined process to make me get out of my own thought process or my own body memory of how to play music.
Why?
I think with Rusted Root, I've been doing Rusted Root for 30 years. And then when I started going, playing with this band and going in the recording studio, I was like, in my mind, I'm thinking, I have limitations on what the bass should do, what the drums should do, just because it's almost like body memory. Like you've been doing it so long that it can't help but affect you. So these new predetermined processes were a way for me to like completely lose my mind. I would be on the 20th take and I'd be like, I don't even know if I'm in the studio right now. I don't even know if I'm standing in the studio, if I'm standing in my kitchen. Like I really just completely lose my mind. And you go through some of that stuff and sometimes you get these magical things and I've got layers of it. And it's pretty cool. Like you know, it's really hard to talk about this stuff. And but when the fact that it worked was pretty amazing. Like I went in to I spent a year doing this stuff, or years, and I went in to finally clean it out and see if it would go together. And I almost had like a panic attack because I was like, I've been working years on this. If it doesn't work, it could be a total disaster. Maybe I got to scrap all that work. And, it worked and it's pretty magical what we did.
So what I get from everything you just described is that what you really covet in the initial state is the freeform aspect of it, that it's not in your headspace. It's in the creative energy of it, almost forcing yourself not to have structure and allow it to flow through you and out of you. But then the second challenge which might be rewarding is taking all those bare elements of free form and trying to put it together into a cohesive composition, which inherently creates structure coming out of a place of no structure.
Correct.
Is that fair?
Yeah.
To say it that way?
Absolutely. Because, I mean, working on a computer, there's no way you can get away from structure and using your mind. I mean, it's just working on a computer, you're automatically going into that mind space, which is the exact space I want to stay away from. But if I can gather layers of moments where we've completely lost our minds and this magical raw emotion is coming through, And then all these pieces are starting to work together. Once they start to work together, and then these other ideas pop out, that's unbelievable. Like, but there's a lot of control in it. I mean, you have to go back and you have to spend hours and hours to get this stuff to work together.
How can folks find the upcoming album, and what's the best way to access it?
You can find a new album. It's going to be coming out in about 3 months. We'll probably start dropping some singles.
So toward the end of the year.
Yeah. Which we'll drop some singles first, but michaelglabicki.com and Uprooted featuring Michael Glabicki of Rest of Root on Instagram and Facebook. We'll start dropping some singles there.
Last question for you. What's left for you to do?
I think this album. I think this album is it.
That's it?
For me. I mean, for right now, I'm like, this is it.
Unlike you to say.
I think this album is it's the all the work that I've put together every 30 years, and the
culmination of
it's the culmination of everything, and I don't really care. Like, even if if three people hear it, it's the work that I'm doing now, and I'm completely satisfied with just doing the work and having the result be that I love it.
But you love it.
I love it. Like, I truly love it. Like, I've never been happy with recordings. And I love this recording. Like, there, it just makes me laugh and smile. And people that hear it, that know me, that have known me over the years and know me for 30 years, hear it and go like, oh my God, like, what? How did this happen? because they know me, and this is what I want to do. Yeah,
it's almost like all of this is getting to a place of finding your true voice.
Yeah,
I hope this is it.
Yeah, I mean, it's the most advanced art I've ever done. Even the guitar work on the record, I've had multiple layers of losing my mind, structuring these ideas together, these gem moments where this magic happens, and putting them together. It's really special. It's really magical.
Thank you so much for being part of our experience. You really brought an amazing amount of joy to our Union Township. And I know you passed by Route 78 and stopped at Clinton Station Diner from time to time, but
I love the Clinton Station Diner. I've been there many, many times and love it, and love to come back and do this again. This is a good crowd. This was like a musically aware crowd. I loved it.
You fit right in, and you were a tremendous gift to us. So thank you.
Thank you.
Well, pick me up with golden hand. Oh, Betsail, oh, Betsail, you to run.
All the way, all the way.
Nobody say, nobody on. Well, I would like to hold my little hand. How we bell run, how we bell cry. I would like to hold my little hand. How we bell run.
That was incredible, man. That was it, man. Not bad. That was fantastic.
All right.
I'm glad you were here.
Really?
Channel by Almost Famous.
All right. We didn't even talk about ping pong.
Well, no, hey, tell you what.
Whatever.
Wait. We got to talk about ping pong.